1960, violence and chaos. Only 11 days after independence from Belgium, the Congolese troops mutinied and began a wave of attacks and looting throughout the far-flung sectors of the country. The former Belgian Congo faces civil war. In the heart of Africa, the country is divided. The mineral-rich province of Katanga, ruled by the Belgium-supported President Kachambi, battles for independence. As law and order breaks down, Belgian colonial settlers are attacked, resulting in United Nations troops being on the ground in July of 1960. Soldiers from the Irish Army are part of the early contingent. The Defence Forces launched a speedy formation of two battalions. Unfortunately, these battalions were not equipped, trained or prepared for this operation. It was the first major peacekeeping force from Ireland. They departed Ireland under a fanfare of excitement as over 200,000 people turned out to bid them farewell. They boarded the American Globemaster aircraft in Valdano. They had never been on a plane previously. When American pilots and crewmen saw the Irish soldiers in heavy army bull's wool uniforms, ox blood coloured boots and leggings, they were dumbfounded with amazement, as the soldiers were heading to a tropical climate in this totally unsuitable gear. When they arrived in Katanga, they immediately felt the tension in the air and on the ground. As the Irish soldiers got on with their difficult and dangerous United Nations peacekeeping duties, they soon built up a good relationship with the local Congolese, who would come into the Irish camp every day to sell fruit and local wares, which they refer to as mingies. But at no time did the Irish become complacent. And very soon the situation changed. A new word was to enter the Irish vocabulary, the word Baluba. The Baluba were opposed to President Kachambi and the independence of Katanga from the Congo. Ghettoized in camps, the Baluba lived in fear of the Kantigliese troops. On the 8th of November 1960, an 11-man Irish United Nations patrol left the village of Nyamba in two Land Rovers to repair a bridge destroyed by Baluba tribes in the previous day. When they arrived at the bridge, they were immediately surrounded by over 100 Balubas who came out of the bush unexpectedly. The Irish soldiers were instructed not to fire on the Balubas as per the United Nations mandate. The Balubas suddenly attacked with bow and arrow, spears, clubs, knives and machetes, resulting the slaughter of 8 Irish soldiers, with only 2 survivors and 1 missing in action. It was estimated that over 500,000 people in Dublin turned out to pay their respects to our fallen soldiers. This was the saddest military funeral witnessed by them, never seen before and not seen to this present day. The situation continued to worsen in the Congo, and 1 year later, once again, the lives of the Irish soldiers were put at risk. Our soldiers did not go to the Congo to fight and kill. They went to keep the peace. The Irish soldiers were put on active duty, rounding up Belgian, French mercenaries and Cantonese who had a huge stake in Katanga's wealth. They resented the Irish United Nations. Jadotville had been controlled by Belgium, French mercenaries and Cantonese troops. Swedish United Nations troops stationed in Jadotville, seeing that they were not wanted and pulled out, knowing they had a good reason to do so. Despite the hostile and dangerous situation in Jadotville, the Irish soldiers of a company were ordered to go into Jadaville. They had inadequate and old unsuitable transport, thereby having to leave ammunition and supplies behind. On arrival, the Irish soldiers were told they were not wanted and to leave immediately or be attacked and slaughtered. The white settlers saw the United Nations as a threat to their governance and wealth. The Irish soldiers, in suspecting trouble, immediately dug trenches to protect themselves. If they had not done so, they would not be here to tell their story. Suddenly, the Irish soldiers were attacked by heavy machine gun and mortar fire, having to return fire to protect themselves. The 156 Irish soldiers were surrounded by well over 3,000 mercenaries and troops. This was the first time any of these Irish soldiers had ever been under live firing. They faced the prospect of death under hostile and dangerous conditions. Throughout the battle, the man in command, Commandant Quinlivan, continually demanded backup, ammunition and supplies, which fell on deaf ears by the United Nations headquarters. Low on ammunition, water and food, the troops bravely battled on, outnumbered by thousands of enemies who suffered huge casualties. Wounded and demoralized, they were sent back retreating every time they were attacked. The Irish did not suffer a single fatality. They survived the siege of Jadaville. They had defended their trenches, suffered onslaught, attacked from land and air, not losing a single life. But over 300 Cantonese were killed during the battle, with many more injured and missing. After 5 grueling days and nights of battle, a ceasefire was agreed. This agreement was broken by the Cantonese, who surrounded and took the Irish prisoners when they realised the Irish were completely out of supplies. The story of the Irish soldiers' captivity became a media circus. They were put on display for the world press, resulting in false and mixed reports daily. Rumours circulated through the media that it was a surrender and not a ceasefire. After 60 days held captive, on the 26th of October 1961, the Irish soldiers were freed. When they returned to the United Nations headquarters, they faced a mixed reception. It was Christmas 1961 when the Irish men returned home. The traumatic events in Jadaville deeply affected the Irish soldiers who lived through it. For many years, questions about the events at Jadaville and the ceasefire cast a shadow over the Irish soldiers of a company. These heroes came from Ireland, perhaps never seeing a black person before they arrived in Africa. They were sent on a United Nations mission with inadequate training, outdated equipment, and no experience in the role of peacekeeping. Their own initiative and common sense made them professional soldiers overnight. They were the forefathers of the United Nations peacekeepers, and it is evident from the role our troops play today make us the most professional in the world. 45 years later, these soldiers were honoured with a scroll and memorial plaque at Costume Barracks at Lome. At last, these heroes received the recognition they had sought all these years. But many have passed away and will never see the plaque in Athlone. In 2016, the surviving heroes and the next of kin of those who have passed away were awarded a citation by the Minister responsible for Defence, Mr. Paul Keogh. Did these heroes receive the recognition they deserve? It's for you to decide. A citation with not even their names on it. Where were the Distinguished Service Medals that were awarded to other personnel for bravery?